Praise your name. Praise your name.
Need every circumstance.
Amen.
Praise your name.
Yes.
Praise
your name. Keep the words and excellence enter the gates.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh,
different time for me to minister, and I need an extra portion of God's anointing. Not only that, it's a different time for you to be receiving. It's a different context. Different things are happening in your life. Your needs right now are different than they have been in the years and the months prior. Let's pray that we would receive everything God has for us. I don't want to come to the table of God's bounty and leave hungry. I don't want to come to the armory of the Lord and leave unprotected. And I don't want that for you. Having the heart of a pastor, I want what's best for you, and I am convinced that it is the things of God. And so let's pray that we would receive the things of God here today. As His presence is here. Dear Lord, we feel Your presence in this place. Dear Lord, truly it is a fact that we're two or three gathered in Your name. You're in the midst of them. And God, You do inhabit the praises of Your people. And as we call on that name, Jesus, 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 Lord, we need You to be Lord of our lives. And God, we need Your provision. Dear Lord, You know what we need better than we know what we need. And so, God, I pray You would turn these situations around for good. Because, God, we proclaim that we love You. And dear Lord, You do that work for us. And God, we know that Your mind toward us is good and not evil. And so God, show us the good that could be coming out of this, dear Lord. Shape us and mold us through these situations. Seize the opportunities that are in our lives, God. Dear Lord, answer the prayers of Your people. And dear Lord, in this time, this hour, when everything is different, God, I pray, dear Lord, that You would make Your difference known in our lives. In Jesus' name. Dear Lord, let us receive all that You have. God, I pray You would apply through the power of Your Spirit the Word to our hearts. Dear Lord, that it would be a change. God, that we wouldn't leave the way that we'd left before, that we'd have new questions and new answers. Dear Lord, new activities of faith to pursue You in Jesus' name. Thank You, God, for Your presence that is here. Lord, have its effect. Lord, do Your work here on us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, we're ready to receive. In Jesus' name. Amen. Would you say amen with me?
Amen.
I'm so glad to have so many here. I certainly didn't know what to expect today, just as I haven't known what to expect all month. You are welcome to be seated, and thank you for worshiping together. It does my soul good to hear and see others worship. It does my soul good to participate with you. I appreciate worship leaders who, even when I don't feel like worshiping, lead me into a place of worship. They give me the words to say when maybe the words have been beat out of me. And I hope that you brought a Bible of your own, maybe even on your smartphone, because we haven't the capacity to put the words on the screen. But I have a word that I've been praying about, and I received some time ago to share with you, and I expect it's going to be a powerful thing. And these aren't all notes, don't be afraid. But the core of the message, just to jump to the end, and then we'll get into the word, is that you're not alone. In this or anything else, in your private life, in your personal struggles, when everybody else has been separated away from you, you are not alone. What you have is actually God's best, and that is His grace. In everything, even the things that separate you from others, you get offended at somebody and you cut off that relationship, you have God's grace in the midst of that offense. When you've been robbed and stolen from, somebody has taken something away from you, or life has been unfair and you feel lonely because you are without now, you still have God's grace. And God's grace overrides everything, and you are not alone. God is on your side. You have His confidence, and you have His righteousness, and you have His victory, all of these imparted to you through His grace. Grace is such an important concept, and it really is the basis of all of Christianity, but I find that it's not very well understood, and it's very poorly applied oftentimes. This grace, which is the basis of life, to begin with, and then the basis of salvation, life more abundantly, that grace, we need to take hold of it. It's the best gift of God. It is His greatest gift, and it is actually already imparted to every person because we're not judged yet for the sins that we've done. He's given us grace to find salvation, grace, yes, to receive His blessings, grace to be saved from the power and the effects of sin on our souls. Every person is saved from wrath right now. Amen. Because we deserve judgment for what we've done. But God is holding back wrath in His great grace. God's grace is given again and again and again. It has been pointed out the failings of our nation, that our nation would deserve wrath, but God has grace. The world is in a state very often that is anti-God, and God could come and be anti-world again and end everything and shut it down and be justified in doing it, but His great grace is already imparted to you and those that you love and those that you wish would get their life right and those that are so backwards and those that break your heart. God's grace is already imparted to them. But we need to receive God's grace. Mm-hmm. We need to let it have its effect on us. Amen. You've been handed grace. Now what are you going to do with it? Because God's grace is powerful. If you're taking notes, that's the first point I want to make to you, that grace is powerful. I want to take you to Acts 20, 32. And if you have a Bible, please turn there. Acts 20, 32, making the point that God's grace is powerful. You might take this as something we all already know, but I feel the need to deliver the Word of God today. So we're going to have a lot of verses. I hope you're okay with that. Okay. Acts 20, verse 32 says, "And now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of His grace." Would you say that with me? The word of His grace?
The word of His grace.
Part of this, the power of grace, is that it comes to you through His word, and His word does not return void. The Word of God is powerful, and it gives us an understanding of His grace that we wouldn't understand naturally. How could we grasp the grace of God on our own? But no, God has inspired His Word and preserved His Word and given us His Word today, and God's inspired a preacher to deliver His Word to you today on the basis of His grace. And so I commend you to God and to the Word of His grace, which is able to build you up.
Thank you, Jesus,
that He doesn't leave us laid low by sin. Thank you, Jesus, He doesn't leave us trampled on by life. But by His grace, He is able to build you up, it says, and to give you an inheritance among all them which are sanctified. Not just built up in this world, but built up in such a way you can expect to be pure and holy and deserving of heaven by His grace. His grace is powerful. His grace will change everything about you. He will build you up. You might feel like, "I'm nobody, I'm nothing, I failed all the time." By His grace, you could be built up to say, "I'm a child of God. Jesus loves me.
Yes.
I've got the truth and you need to hear about it. I'm ready to pray for you and God answers my prayers." You could be built up by His grace if you would receive it. He's already given it to you. He's already poured it out across the world. The world isn't in flames yet. Mm-hmm. Receive His grace into your life and be built up by the power of His grace so that you could have an inheritance among them that are sanctified. We look at the great heroes of faith and we can say, well, man, what faith they had. But what they had was faith by grace.
Amen.
God had given them grace and they grew in that, and you could grow in that also to have an inheritance among them that are sanctified, set apart, that are pure and holy like God is holy. How do we become pure and holy like God is holy? We receive that first thing from God, His grace. And then we receive His righteousness.
Amen.
Replacing our righteousness, which is like filthy rags. The word of His grace that I'm preaching to you is able to build you up. Would you let me build you up in His grace?
Amen.
Would you receive His grace today? Would you be open to greater grace? If you receive the grace of God, if you receive it, everything's going to change in your life. You're not going to be walk around like a whipped dog with your tail between your legs. You're not going to be dragging around. God's grace is going to build you up. And God is building you up to be a part of those who are going to heaven. Too many people say, "I hope I'll make it to heaven." When you ask people, "Are you ready to go to heaven?" they say, "I hope so." You, by the grace of God, you could know. You could be sure.
Right.
Having an inheritance, being counted with those that are predestined to heaven.
Amen.
God's grace is powerful to change you, and I implore you today, receive that grace. Receive that grace. He wants you to. Don't try and go it alone. Don't try and do this life on your own. Don't try to build your own ladder to heaven through good works or education or whatever other means you might try to find. Don't try to feel your way through the darkness of this world and to find your way to heaven. Don't trust your feelings. Receive His grace found in His word. Receive the word of grace and be built up. Grace is powerful, and grace very often also is perverted.
Mm-hmm.
Grace is perverted in our world. The devil perverted the word of God when he tricked Eve into eating the fruit of the forbidden tree. It perverted God's word. He said, did God say? Twisting God's word. And God will deceive even the very elect, the Bible says, into believing that grace, the work of grace, is automatic. Into believing that grace doesn't require anything of the recipient. That grace will automatically override and purify any sin, and that thereby you have a license to sin. And that is a perversion of Scripture. I need to take you to the Word to answer that false doctrine. It's called by many things. One term that I just used outside of that context, greater grace. It's called free grace. It's called irresistible grace. Grace that has no cost. And I come to you telling you today that grace had a great cost at the cross. Grace had a terrible cost. It might not have cost you anything, but it had a terrible cost. And that when we sin without any plan of repentance, when we turn our back on repentance and choose again to break the law of God and the heart of God, when we do these things, denying conviction, having no plan to repent, we spit on the sacrifice of Jesus. Mm-hmm. We defile the blood of the cross. That is not the purpose of the blood of the cross. The blood of the cross was spilled to make people new, to free them from the bonds of slavery and sin and death. That wasn't the purpose of His grace. We need to go to the Bible and undo that false doctrine, because the Nicolaitans believed that. The Nicolaitans' primary doctrine, the thing we know most about them, is that they believed that they could sin in their body without any remorse, without any effect. They believed that all of Christianity was spiritual, and so the body, which was carnal, could sin and have all the pleasures of the world without any effect on their soul. And God says in Revelation 2:6 that He hates them, and He hates their doctrine, and He commends the New Testament church that you hate their doctrine too. In contrast with this defining doctrine that sin didn't matter to God, we learn that sin does matter to God. In Romans 6, 1 and 2, it says, I'm sorry, I'll give you time to get there. Romans 6, 1 and 2. It gives us a contrast to that false doctrine. God's grace is poured out on everybody, but we need to receive it. We need to do the work of applying it to our lives. When we receive it, it's going to make a change in us. And yes, God helps us make the change. And no, we're not able to make the change on our own, but we must be changed by His grace. Romans 6, 1 through 2 says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Should we sin more so that there could be more grace? Could we do that? Could we build more grace for God? Shall we twist the arm of God to pour out more grace and shake it out of Him like a bully with the lunch money upside down? No, God forbid. Verse 2, God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? It is by the grace of God that we are freed from sin. And so we should not continue in sin using grace as our excuse. Mm-hmm. Making God complicit in our evil. Saying God said it was okay. His grace is going to override it anyway. I can continue on in my selfishness and perversion and all the different things that I want to do because I am a corrupt person. No, God is ready to lift you out of your corruption by the power of His grace. Don't make God complicit in your sin, saying that He is going to go ahead and pay for it as I run rampant through this world in destruction. No, God has not done that. God is ready to save you out of your old ways and make you powerful over sin. 2 Corinthians 9:8 takes it further. 2 Corinthians 9:8 shares with us that God again forbids that we would continue in sin and be enslaved. God's grace is here to free you. Make you free from those desires and selfish things that you know are going to destroy you. You know there's a cost, not only in eternity, but in this world, to do evil and wickedness. God wants to free you from that. 2 Corinthians 9:8 says, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. People say, well, I just can't help it. I'm a sinner and I've been broken and I'm in these habits and I believe them. They can't help it until they receive grace. until God comes on the scene, until they give themselves over to what God is ready to do in their life, then they can help it and they can abound to every good work. They can replace the evil works of selfishness and the evil works of the devil, of the ruler, the power of this era, the evil works that were implanted in them, maybe even by their family through traditions and habits and wrong thinking when they told them they weren't worth anything and things like that. You can replace all of that with good works through grace. God forbid that you would continue to be enslaved by sin, continue to be slowly strangled by sin. God's grace is pure. It will not be defiled. Some people will try to make God complicit, God a part of their sin by saying, well, God is paying for it as I do it, and I needn't worry about the effects of what I do in this world. They will try, but they will find that bill is still theirs to pay. Because while God gives grace to everyone right now, it is up to us to receive His grace. It is up to us to apply His grace. It is up to us to submit to His grace and to receive it. God's hand is open. God is ready to give, but we must receive like so often every other thing. God's grace is powerful, and God's grace might be perverted by some, but not by us. And God's grace is purposeful. There's a purpose to God's grace. God isn't just throwing glitter of grace around willy-nilly. There's a purpose that God has commended grace toward your soul. Matthew 18, 21 through 22 shares with us His purpose in giving us His grace. It isn't just that God can't help it. God could help it. Look at Noah. God could help it. God said that He would not always tarry with man. There is another judgment coming. God can help it. But Matthew 18, 21 through 22 gives us the purpose of God's grace. Maybe you've never asked this question. Why is there grace? Then came Peter to Him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? And I'm sure that Peter thought he was being generous, saying, well, should I give somebody seven times to sin against me before I stop forgiving them? And Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. How many times can someone backslide in this church and still keep coming? 70 times seven. How many times can somebody choose against the things of God and still be loved by God? 70 times seven. And that the context gives that per day. God's grace is patient. God's grace is greatly patient.
Thank you, Lord.
His patience is not going to be exhausted by you and I. His patience is immense as His grace. Just as He would cast your sins into the sea of forgetfulness, departing them from you as far as the east is from the west, His patience is that great.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Lord.
His patience is overwhelming. His patience is inexhaustible. Why? Why is God's patience so great? Is it because it doesn't matter? Is it because it doesn't matter that we sin? No. God's patience is so great because it matters more than anything. Because grace is the antidote to sin.
Yes.
And slavery and death that come with sin. It's so important that you would have grace. And so God is patient. And even though you are running the exact opposite direction from God, God is patient, ready for you to repent and turn toward Him. It is the most important thing. It isn't that God doesn't care, and so grace is free, and grace is given to all, and grace is always available. No, it isn't that. It doesn't matter. It's that it matters so very much. And so His grace is always open. God's grace is patient. I'm sorry, I skipped the purpose of God's grace. God's grace is purposeful, and I need to take you to Romans 5:20 to talk about the purpose of God's grace, the reason for God's grace. Romans 5:20, getting to that, we just talked about how God's grace is patient. Romans 5:20 says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. The purpose of grace is that it will overwhelm your sins. It will allow you, if you will receive God's grace, it will allow you to become an overcomer to your sinful life. Where great sin abounded, grace did much more abound. You have sin in your life and you feel like nobody could do anything with me? You're wrong. The Bible says God inspired and preserved until today and has inspired a preacher to preach to you today that the heap of sin that you've had in your life, that you're ashamed of, that you can't even hide anymore, His grace is ready to overcome that. His grace is ready to cover that, to push that out of your life. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. God will overcome your sin, and in His grace, applying that to your life, you are able to be an overcomer in this present world.
Amen.
I need to take you to Titus 2, 11 through 12 to make this point further. God's grace has a purpose for you. It isn't just that God is this way and I'm over here. God's grace has a purpose for your life. Titus 2, 11 through 12 says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." That's the point I was making before. Everybody's received God's grace. Everybody understands that I've done wrong and I deserve judgment, but somehow the other shoe hasn't dropped. That's God's grace and love applied to your life.
Yes.
"Hath appeared to all men," verse 12, "teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly." God's grace has a purpose. We should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, not someday, not when I grow up, not once I get my money right, not once the kids are grown, not once I get to heaven, then I'm going to live righteously, soberly, godly. No, in this present world, after grace has saved you, grace continues. After grace has saved you, grace continues to teach you how to live, to empower you to be able to live righteously. I want you to repeat that with me. Could we read that? Or you, if you don't have it to read, could you repeat with me? I'm just going to take it word by word, phrase by phrase. Titus 2, 12 says this. Just repeat after me. Teaching us that.
Teaching us that.
Denying ungodliness.
Denying ungodliness.
And worldly lusts.
And worldly lusts.
We should live soberly.
We should live soberly.
Righteously.
Righteously.
And godly.
And godly.
In this present world.
In this present world.
That might be the most important part. We know that God, the will of God for us is to be free from sin. But free when? In this present world. Jesus said, "Behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. It's within reach." You could live righteously by the power of God today. You could be free from your sins. You could be sober again. You could overcome and be an overcomer.
Amen.
Full of the grace that overcomes. Able to overcome every temptation that comes later because you've received grace and you don't have to be that person anymore. You don't have to be a slave to those habits and desires and appetites anymore. An overcomer, that's who you are now because you've received grace and applied it to your life. Praise God.
Amen.
In this present world.
Yes.
Hallelujah. How is all this? How is God's grace powerful and purposeful and patient? I've been describing grace, but you might wonder, if you're a critical thinker, you might wonder, well, you haven't really told us what grace is. You've been describing what grace does and such as that. What is grace itself? The theologian's answer is this. If you go to Bible school or seminary, they'll tell you this is the definition of grace. It is unmerited favor. And that's true. It is unmerited favor, but that doesn't really apply to my life all that great. It isn't, it's a concept. It's not so much an action. And so I want to give you another definition of grace that falls within that unmerited favor. Because that's technically right, but in my life, and as I'm raising kids and toddlers, I need a definition of grace I can work with. We need a definition of grace that could really change our lives. I need to know grace personally, not just like the theologians would say. And I could be technically right, but actually wrong. I need to receive grace. What is grace, preacher? Grace is a window. Grace is a window. An opening in the wall that you've been pressed against. Life is trying to crush you. Culture is trying to crush the life out of you. And God's grace is a window for you. God has made a way. God's grace is universal in that we do not pay for our sins presently, but God's grace applied to your life is there is a window for you. God says that when darkness rules, you can have light. God's grace is a window, shining that light into your life, letting you know that there is more and greater, and there is hope. Where you didn't feel there was hope. That when depression hits, grace is a window. Grace is a window shining the goodness of God in your life. God's window shines in our lives that we might understand things better. When confusion covers us with a blanket of darkness, we can't even see our nose, God's window of grace will shine in. By the power of His presence and His Spirit, by the power of His Word, by the power of His church, His understanding and His take on things will shine into your life. That's why we have the gifts of the Spirit, things like wisdom and knowledge. God's grace is shining. God says that when temptation comes, that He will make a way of escape for you. Maybe you know that scripture. God's grace is a window. It's a window you can crawl through. It's a window you can escape through. When the room is on fire, you can get out. When it's all danger there and there's nothing good there that could sustain you, you can get out of your situation. Temptation is here ready to take you down. Like a lion takes down a gazelle, but there's a window of escape made for you. God's grace is a window. God's grace is not only a window of escape, but you might say of your own situation that you're a prisoner. You're a prisoner of your own doing. You shut the door. Maybe the enemy locked it. You feel trapped in your present situation. God's grace is a window. God's grace is a window that you might be delivered from your situation. How many prisoners wish that the windows didn't have bars? Well, God's grace doesn't have bars on it. He keeps it open toward you, ready for the freshness of His grace to come into your life, always reminding you, you've got a way. You've got a way. You find yourself mired in the darkness. You've got a way of escape. You find yourself trapped on every side. You don't know how to get out. Start praying. Reach for the window of grace. Receive from God. God's grace is a window for you. Be delivered. God's grace is powerful. God's grace, some would try to pervert it, but it's pure. They're the result of that teaching there, that God's grace is sometimes perverted. God's grace is actually pure. God's grace is powerful. It's pure. It has a purpose. God's grace is patient. And this grace applied to your life is a window. A window. God's grace, I know I've been saying God's grace is, and then using a word that starts with P, I'm going to frustrate the note takers. God's grace is deliverance. This isn't a sermon that fits in a tidy box and an oratory skill. This sermon is from the Word of God. God's grace is deliverance. Let's go to Romans 8:2. This window was placed by God for your benefit, that you would be able to be delivered from this world that you cannot escape without sin. We are broken people. We cannot escape sin. We've been given a sin nature, a propensity to sin. We can't make it. All have sinned and gone astray. But God has commended toward you the word of His grace, that you could be built up. You could be lifted up. You could be changed. Romans 8:2 says, "For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death." You could be free. God's grace will remake you. Give yourself over to grace. Leave the law of sin and death. Don't you know that it's the law of God that sin, the wages of sin, are death? Don't you know that what you plant, you're going to reap? Don't reap corruption because you planted a life of corruption. Rather, be remade and delivered from the law of sin and death, and be delivered to the freedom of Christ, the freedom to do what you should. Paul wrote about it. He says, "The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." So give yourself over to the Spirit and be filled with grace. Give yourself over to spiritual things and be filled with grace, and leave carnal flesh behind. Be controlled and submitted to God. You could be delivered. God has proven that He will love you because you haven't died yet. You haven't been judged for your sins yet. God has proven that He loves you. His Bible is full of the truth of His love toward you, that He is for you and He is not for your destruction. Who better to rely on than the God of grace? Where else are you going to get this kind of help? Yourself, you'll say, yeah, I deserve to be to pay for my sins. I deserve to pay for the wrong I thought I got away with. A righteous God wouldn't let me into heaven, except that by His grace, He's going to give you His righteousness. He's going to remake you in righteousness. He's going to remove your sins from you? Who better to rely on? Hasn't God been faithful to you? Can't you look back in your history and say, yeah, when I prayed, he answered. Yeah, God gave me some things that were too good for me. I didn't deserve my spouse. I didn't deserve my children. I don't deserve the health I have right now. Hasn't God been good to you? Who better to rely on than the God of grace? The gift of grace is needed by everyone in a greater degree. The grace that's imparted to everyone is a sample. You need to go get the whole thing. Grace needs to move from being an outside thing to being received by you, being an inward thing that changes you from the inside. There are no Christians without God's grace. And there are no people that don't need God's grace. I want to share with you a testimony. I want to close with this, a testimony and a scripture from a friend. Maybe you know Scott Phillips. He shared this, and I want to share it with you because it brings this point to a personal place. This truth that God will deliver you from the law of sin and death to the liberty of grace. He said a young lady who was in the past worshiping the devil and involved in occult music was raised for all intents and purposes a heathen. Maybe it sounds like some of your friends. Sounds like some of my friends. Raised just without God. Raised to do whatever she felt. Raised to seek power in pagan places. He says she, in desperation, in the fear that she had, the oppression that was on her, and even possession, called all the area churches in the little town she lived in Mississippi. And she called every church begging for help. She understood that this was killing her. As a final resort, she finally called the Pentecostal church, though she was very adverse. I will never be a Pentecostal, she had said in times past. The pastor, Shannon Pennington, took her call, and he and his wife met her at the church and cast the devil out of her, baptizing her, and she received a glorious Holy Ghost experience. Later, a young man with a very similar background began being tormented by spirits in his life. She said, "Tell him if he will completely surrender and submit to God, everything, the demons will have no power over him." That sounds biblical to me. Now, this is a new convert, and she probably doesn't know the verse. But the Bible says that the temptations take hold of unrepentant lusts, and they conceive sin, and sin eventually leads to death. And so her advice was, surrender your everything to God's grace, and the devil won't have any say in it. He won't have any handhold in your life. There won't be any way in for him. I have shared this truth with many, many people. I've shared this truth with many, many people. And some people's response is polite rejection. Oftentimes, people's response is polite rejection. If they're not in the place where they just have exhausted their options, very often the grace of God, they don't connect to it. And they'll say things like, "I think we all serve God in our own way." They'll say things like, "I don't think God requires all that." They'll say things like, "That doesn't fit me." Many words you'll hear these people resist, and I don't see them get delivered. I stay in touch with everybody. It is the heart of a pastor to stay in touch with people and continue to reach and be available to teach and pray and support, hoping that soul would turn around. And as I do that, I am consistently pained to see what goes on in their life. I tell you now, like I told them, if you want deliverance, serving God your own way has you oppressed, fearful, and in the grip of the enemy. Serving God any old way, any way that you feel, serving God the ways that you have in the past, if you're not receiving the benefits of grace, then you still need to surrender to God and His grace. You need to give Him your everything. If you want deliverance, you must surrender to God. You must receive His grace without perverting it or changing it or filing off the corners. You must receive His grace as it is commended to you in the Word of grace. His grace must be received on His terms because it's His grace. We don't deserve it. We didn't make it. It's His grace. We must receive it on His terms. We must submit to His grace. Don't be left still oppressed and in the grip of Satan. James 4, 6 through 8 is the verse that my friend tied to that testimony. He said, Satan has no power over a person who will obey this simple scripture. James 4, 6 through 8. Sis, would you come and play something? We're going to pray, and I'm going to ask you to pray where you are. Typically, we come together and pray, but for everybody's comfort and safety, I don't want anybody not praying because they're uncomfortable. I'm going to ask you to pray where you are. Would you stand and read this verse with me? If you have the ability to read it, if you brought a Bible, James 4, 6 through 8. This is the power of God in the Word of God. It says, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but give grace. God resists the proud. If you're going to be too proud to go God's way, if you're going to be too proud to submit to the way of God, God resists you. God holds back the good things that he had for you. God resists the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Humble yourself and submit to God. Submit yourselves, this is the Bible, James 4, 6 through 8. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. This is the work of grace. That you would purify your hearts, that you would wash your hands by grace, that you would have the power to even resist the devil by his grace. But before I said you could resist, and people love to quote that scripture, resist the devil. Before that, he said, be humble and receive his grace. If you want the power to resist the devil, you find yourself falling into the same sins again and again, and you're frustrated and you don't know if you can do it anymore. Let me testify to you, you can't do it anymore. You were right. But if you will humbly submit to God and receive his grace, if you would stop being so proud that I'm going to hold back this part of my life from God, I've got this part under control, I'm not going to submit it to God. He can have the broken pieces. No, God wants all of you. Submit yourself, be humble before God, and find yourself able to resist the devil. Find yourself able to draw closer to God like you wish you could draw closer to God. And he'll draw close to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts. If you've been double-minded, not sure if you're ready to commit to God, not sure you're even able to live a Christian life, how often has that been all of us? I don't know if I can even live this way anymore. Being double-minded, I want to, but I don't. Purify your hearts. Wash your hands. Commit yourself to God. Receive his grace humbly. The window of grace will not always be open. And so we need to crawl through that window that God has provided. No, not everything's going to fit. You're going to have to leave some things behind as you take advantage of God's grace. Your baggage of things you were so proud of, you're going to have to leave that behind and humbly crawl through the grace, the window of grace. But the room you're in is on fire. The room you're in, you can't stay there. The room you're in is not sustaining you. There's nothing there that's going to keep you alive. You're a prisoner right now. Crawl through the window of grace. I need to apply grace now, and then we're going to pray. Because we have such great grace, we are able to repent. And I call you, if you have anything to repent of, repent now. Submit yourself to God and repent. Because we have such great grace, we can be baptized in Jesus' name. That name that is greater than every other name, that only saving name by which we must be saved, that name has been given to you the authority to baptize in Jesus' name. Be baptized in Jesus' name. Wash away your sins using that only saving name. Receive grace. Because we've received such great grace, you could receive the gift and the promise of the Holy Ghost. Surrender your spirit and all of its weakness and receive his spirit, completely surrendering to him. Let's take some time to pray today. Let's take a little bit of time. Let's surrender ourselves to God. It could be a quiet prayer. Nobody else needs to hear you but Jesus. But it's time that we receive grace. It's time that we allow grace to have its work in our lives. Not pretending that that grace isn't going to change us, but rather accepting the change that grace brings. I'm going to pray with you, and I want you to pray in your own words. This isn't a repeat after me, Simon Says prayer. This is a personal thing where you get together with God. His presence is in this room.